Morning, everyone. Thanks, everyone, for attending. Well, before starting, I'd just like to thank everyone at Sport Canada and SCRI for this opportunity for us academic to, first of all, do research on topics that we really care and like about, and to be able to share it with people who are not necessarily people that we talk to on a regular basis, so policymakers, people at the government. So it's a great opportunity this morning to have the opportunity to talk about research. Just want to start with kind of a pitch-in into my project. Have you ever encountered any athlete, any professional, any coaches who don't have any goals? Is there anyone in this room who doesn't have any goals? It's quite a rare thing when I ask this question to have people raising their hands saying, I don't have any goals. Everyone has goals. But the thing is that the goals can be quite different from one person to the other. Even in your own personal life, the type of goal that you can have can be quite different when you refer to sport versus when you refer to your work activities on a daily basis. So goal is, by definition, something that is ubiquitous in the life of people, but that varies a lot from one person to the other, and even from within the same person across time and across context. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about something we call goal motivation. There has been thousands of studies done in work, education, and sport looking at the effectiveness of goal setting. But the truth is, regardless of the fact that newspapers about 10 times a year are going to say, well, you should set goals because it's a very effective strategy. In fact, goal setting is not that much of an effective strategy in and out of itself. You're going to need some other ingredient to make the goal setting intervention work. And this is what I'm going to talk to you about today, some of these ingredients that can improve the effectiveness of the goal setting intervention. So overall, a goal is a mental representation of what you want to be attaining in a situation. You can divide goals in as many categories as you would like, but researchers, we like to use two big dimensions. Mastery goals that have to do with learning, self-improvement, attaining, getting to the best of your capacity and your potential, and the performance goal, which are kind of normative goals in which you compare yourself to other people, where you want to outperform and do better compared to other people. What the literature shows is that basically the mastery goal seems to be very effective to increase the quality of the experience, the extent to which people are satisfied in the activities that they're doing. Whereas the performance goal, wanting to do better compared to other people, seems to be better in terms of improving performance, or the bottom up, the bottom line outputs that most athletes and most coaches are interested in. But you also need to find a balance between both of them to ensure that your athletes are both satisfied and achieving to the best of their potential. The problem with goals is that they don't take into account the reasons why people have them. You can have a student or you can have an athlete having the goals to be the best person in the world in sports. And then you ask them the follow-up question, well, but why do you want to be the best? Why do you want to win a medal at the next Olympic game? And again, you're going to find different reasons or different motivations that underlie the goals that people are pursuing. And we think that the reasons are probably as important, if not even more important than the goal in and out of itself. So broadly, you can define goal motivation using two categories. The autonomous motivation, which is basically, I do it because it's fun, I do it because it's important for me, I do it because it's something that is consistent with my interest, my value, and who I am as a person. And then you have the more controlled goal, which are basically, I do it because I feel pressure to do it. I do it because I feel I should. I do it because I want to avoid feeling bad about myself. And what we know is that generally people who are pursuing autonomous goals are more likely to attain them than people who are pursuing more out of a controlled form of motivation. But both in the sport domain, in the work domain, and in the school domain, a lot of the goals that the kids and the employees set for themselves are controlled goals. They are not necessarily goals that stems from their interests, their values, and who they are as person. So what do we know, and what can happen when people pursue achievement goals for different types of reason? Well, basically, we did about, with this grant and with some other grants that we have with students, we've did about 10 studies trying to see what happens when people set goals for different reasons. And it seems to be the case that if you have a performance goal, wanting to outperform other people, do better than others, be amongst the best in a certain activity, if you are pursuing these goals for autonomous reason, you're going to end up both performing well and being quite satisfied with the whole experience and the domain that you're involved. So it seems to be that performance goal can be good for both the experience or the quality of the experience and the performance if you pursue them for reasons that are consistent with your value, your interest, and who you are as a person. And the same thing happens for the mastery goals. Mastery goals have been puzzling educational researchers and sport researchers for the last 15 years because we were not able to show that they were leading to any type of advantages when it comes to predicting and understanding performance. The reason why we think it was the case is because we did not consider the reason why they were being pursued. But when we do so, what we're able to show is that the kids, the employees, and the students who want to learn, improve, and get to the best of their potential, if they do it for reasons that are closely aligned to their value, their interest, and their self, they're going to end up both performing better, and they're going to end up also being more satisfied with the experience of being either an athlete, an employee, or a student. So all in all, setting goals can be extremely useful to boost both performance and the experience of the activities you're doing, as long as you are doing it for reasons that are aligned with who you are as a person. So that's the first important take-home message of this line of research. We also did some other studies looking at motivation for the activity. So why do you do sport? Why are you engaging in sport participation? And we did a bunch of studies, so I'm just going to show you a few highlights of some of them this morning. We did a very interesting study with young soccer players. In Quebec, we have something called Les Jeux du Québec. So these are the provincial games. And in all areas or region, you have selection camps that happens that are lasting for about 6 months. So we identify the best, let's say in October, September, October. They're going to train together throughout the fall and the winter. And then early in the spring, we keep the 20 best women and the 20 best male. And they are now the regional team that we are preparing for the provincial game. We measured motivation for sport at the start of the selection campaign in the fall. And we looked at, can we predict who is going to be selected in the team about 6 months after? And what we found is that the kids who had high level of autonomous motivation for sports, so the ones who are doing it because they like it, because it's important to them, because it's part of who they are as a person, they were 3.88 times more likely to be selected in the regional team, which is a huge effect in these type of research. We were also able to find in other studies, including this one and some other ones, that people who do sports for reasons that are more autonomous, they are more successful in managing their stress of both training and competition. They're more likely to use effort, to use more relaxation strategies, to be able to become effective problem solvers when the problem arrives in both the training and the competition. So basically, we are training them for life. If they are really able to do their sport for autonomous reasons, they're going to acquire a skill that is not only useful in the sport domain, but that can be also applicable in the work and in the school when they're going to grow older. Greater likelihood of making progress on their goals and greater likelihood of eventually attaining the goals they set for themselves, which is basically extremely important when we think about having athletes who eventually are going to persist into doing their sports. And we also did some studies within teams and within dyads. A lot of the sports you do, you're generally not alone. You're going to be with teammates. and you're going to be with in some sports such as duo figure skaters or badminton when they're playing in teams, they're going to be interacting with someone else. And they need to coordinate both their effort, but also their motivation to be successful. So having to learn how to work in team is an extremely important component that we can also transfer when the athletes move on into the business world or even in their educational activities as students. And what we find is that the kids, the students, and even the employees, when we do research in the work settings, who have motivation that is more autonomous, they create a spillover on their partners, where even their partner become more autonomously motivated by the fact of having to interact with people who are autonomously motivated. So not only does it affect you as a person, it also is going to be affecting the people you work with on a regular basis to attain common goals. Another thing that we looked at is in a lot of the provinces, you have regional training centers where a lot of resources have been deployed to help the athletes in terms of having access to nutrition, having access to sports psychologists, kind of having an information booth where they can have everything they need at one place. The problem is that not a lot of these resources are used to the full of their potential. A lot of these resources are available, but athletes either don't know about it or they don't use them. And we have the same problem on our campus where we've created all kinds of outstanding resources to help students who are struggling, but the students don't come knocking at our doors. The one who usually come knocking at our doors are the one who don't necessarily need the type of resources that we provide them. So we did a study to try to understand who is more likely to use the resources when they feel that they are struggling within a system. And what we found in the regional training center in Gatineau, just the other side of the river in Outaouais, is that the athletes who are more autonomously motivated and the coaches also who are more autonomously motivated are more likely to come knocking on the door to get the resources. And finally, we also do studies in the lab where we look at learning trajectories and how fast can someone can learn a novel task. So something that is brand new that you've never done before, how many times does it take you to learn something new? And what we find also in these studies is that if you pursue a task with autonomous motivation, you're more likely to improve at a faster rate than if you're pursuing it for controlled motivation. Practical implication. Well, we need to redesign the way we go with goal-setting intervention. Usually, the goal-setting intervention are just asking people, what do you want to do? What do you want to attain? And that's not enough. We need to make sure that we encourage people in setting goals that are important for them. Most of the time, we do goal setting in a way that is prescribed. We say, you should do this. Here's the plan. That's how it should be done. If you want to become an Olympic athlete, you need to go through these steps and these steps. Most of the people could, by themselves, set their own goals and even be more successful. If you have them, discover exactly what is needed to be successful instead of telling them exactly what is needed to be successful. A second important thing is that we know now that one of the best ways to maintain motivation and to increase the motivation of people is through giving them the resource they need to cope with the challenges and the struggles of their daily life when they're doing the activities. So any type of intervention that would teach coping skills to both students, employees, and athletes could go a long way in terms of helping them acquiring and maintaining their motivation. And the third thing that is extremely important is something we call in our motivational lingo, autonomy support. Autonomy support is basically a philosophy in terms of teaching and coaching where you let the athletes discover by themselves what is needed to be successful. So, because I'm a fundamental researcher, just like to make a few disclaimers about everything that I've said. These are correlational findings. We need more research in which we go back to the lab or we go back to the field and we create what we call randomized controlled trials to basically put people either in a control group where they don't have any intervention or an experimental group where they receive an active form of treatment to see if it works. Why is it needed? So we need these types of effective trials in the sport domain to really validate the type of intervention we're doing. And I really believe that psychological science is in a very, very good position to give you a lot of the answers that you need, both from a methodological standpoint, but also from an applied standpoint. So overall, I just want to thank you for your attention, and I just want again to thank everyone at Sport Canada, everyone at CHIRC for the opportunity to do this type of research, which is extremely important for the ones who love sports and who want to make a difference in this life, in this life domain. So thank you very much.